Happy holidays and welcome to White House History Live. My name is Dr. Colleen Shogan, and I'm a Senior Vice President at the White House Historical Association and the Director of the David Rubenstein Center for White House History. The White House Historical Association is a nonpartisan, nonprofit organization with a mission to educate the public about the rich and diverse history of the White House and the people who lived and worked there. Tonight, we will hear from White House Historical Association historian Lina Mann to discuss a new digital exhibit, The President of the United States Meets the King of Rock and Roll. Of course, this exhibit features Elvis Presley's December 21st, 1970 visit to the White House to meet with President Richard Nixon. During tonight's program, we will begin with a discussion about the digital exhibit, and then we will open the floor for questions from our online viewing audience. Let me tell you a little bit about our presenter this evening. Lina Mann joined the White House Historical Association in 2017 as American University's Public History Fellow and began her work as a historian in March of 2020. She is interested in many different aspects of White House history, including her latest research concerning the enslaved individuals who both lived and worked in the White House. As a lifelong Marylander, she also researches local and regional history. Lina received her Bachelor of Arts in History with minors in Anthropology, Environmental Studies, and Museum Studies from St. Mary's College in Maryland in 2016, and earned her Master of Arts in Public History from American University in 2019. Thank you so much for joining us this evening, Lina.
Thank you.
As a reminder for our viewers, if you have any questions for our panelists, please type them into the comments section in the live feed, and we will try to get to as many questions as possible at the end of our presentation. So let's start with the digital exhibit that you curated, Lina. Tell us a little bit about this digital exhibit and tell us what was the inspiration behind it.
Yeah, absolutely. So I have personally always been fascinated with this Elvis Presley visit to the Nixon White House because really the circumstances behind the visit are so unusual. Now, there is a really longstanding tradition of presidents inviting popular performers and artists to the White House. Often, artists are invited to perform for various events, including state dinners and other special performances meant to highlight the best of American culture. So, for example, earlier the same year as this Elvis Presley visit in April of 1970, Johnny Cash and June Carter Cash, they performed for 250 guests as part of a concert series put on by the Nixons called Evening at the White House, and that took place in the White House East Room. But in fact, honestly, we could do a whole other program about just the Johnny Cash visits to the White House. There were many. But in the case of Elvis Presley, it really is quite unusual for a performer to show up out of the blue, as we'll talk about later, and ask for a meeting with the president rather than obtaining a specific invitation. But I guess that is the king of rock and roll for you. And in addition, there is this very, very famous photograph, which hopefully we can bring up in just a second. Yeah, it's loading right now. But this photograph is the most requested photograph from the National Archives. And obviously, this particular photograph strikes a chord with the American people. And when I first saw it, I thought there really has to be a story behind it. So I thought it'd be really interesting to bring more materials from this visit in a digital format because there are really so many excellent photographs of this meeting in addition to this one within the National Archives collection, as well as numerous meeting notes, memos, the letter that Elvis wrote to President Nixon. All of that is part of the National Archives and also the Richard Nixon Presidential Library and Museum. So I thought it would make a great digital exhibit. And I worked on, it's just a short little exhibit. It goes through each element of the meeting. So the prep for the meeting itself, after the meeting, all of that. And also today is a very fitting day to talk about this photograph because this particular historic meeting took place on this day in 1970. So today, I believe, marks 52 years since that particular meeting.
Okay, it is an unusual story. So let's talk about what happened that day chronologically. So we'll start with the events leading up to the meeting on December 21st, 1970. As I understand it, Lina, Elvis showed up at the Northwest Gate of the White House, and he had written a 6-page letter to President Richard Nixon. Can you tell us a little bit about this letter and why he wanted to meet with President Nixon?
Yeah. So in the first section of our digital exhibit, you can actually see the letter that Elvis wrote to President Nixon. Hopefully we'll bring it up in just a second. And our story actually starts sort of a few days prior to that meeting. So a couple days beforehand, Elvis's father, Vernon Presley, who's his and also his business manager, and then his wife, Priscilla Presley, they all got on him complaining about Elvis's excessive spending. Apparently, he had been buying guns, cars, and other expensive gifts, and they essentially tried to rein him in. And as a result of this quarrel, he left Graceland pretty much by himself, which was unusual for him. Usually, he had some sort of entourage around him. And he takes a flight to Washington, D.C. However, once he gets to Washington, D.C., he then boards another flight and goes to Los Angeles, where he ends up picking up his friend Jerry Schilling. So after all of that, about 24 hours later, after he gets to L.A., then they take a red-eye flight back to Washington, D.C., and they arrive early on the morning of the 21st. While they're on the plane, according to Presley's friend Jerry Schilling, Elvis comes up with this idea to write a letter and try and see President Nixon, and he does this on the flight. So happened to be on the flight, there was a senator from California, George Murphy, and Presley ended up speaking to him about this idea that he has. He wants to obtain a badge from the Bureau of Narcotics and Dangerous Drugs, which is today known as the Drug Enforcement Agency, or DEA. And according to Schilling, the plan was to have Senator Murphy deliver the letter to Nixon on his behalf, but then ultimately Elvis decided that a personal delivery would be better. So if you look at the text of this six-page letter, it's really quite interesting. It is written on American Airlines stationery because he writes it on the plane. And so around 6:30 that morning, after he gets off the flight, he arrives to the northwest gate of the White House and hands this letter to a guard. The letter includes several unusual requests. So first of all, he's asking to be made a, quote, federal agent at large. And he also has this sort of offer to help with curbing American drug abuse and other problems because he, quote, has an in with counterculture groups. And I think that there are several important and interesting sections of the letter. So my favorite part says, it's in the beginning, it says, first, I would like to introduce myself. I am Elvis Presley, and I admire you and have great respect for your office. I talked to Vice President Agnew in Palm Springs 3 weeks ago and expressed my concern for our country. The drug culture, the hippie elements, the SDS, Black Panthers, etc., do not consider me as their enemy or, as they call it, the establishment. I call it America and I love it. Sir, I can and will be of any service that I can to help the country out. I have no concern or motives other than helping the country out. So I wish not to be given a title or an appointed position. I can and will do more good if I were made a federal agent at large, and I will help out by doing it my way through my communications with people of all ages. First and foremost, I am an entertainer, but all I need is the federal credentials. In this letter, he goes on to instruct the White House to contact him at the Washington Hotel where he was staying and gives a false name, which he had on his hotel reservation, as John Burroughs. So this very interesting letter is sort of the catalyst for this meeting occurring that morning.
So once he gives the letter to the security guard, what happens next? How does the White House staff receive the letter? And how do they respond? What do they decide to do?
Yes. So if we go to our next section of the exhibit, we actually have my absolute favorite part of this entire situation. So the strange letter, it makes its way through the West Wing while Elvis goes off to his hotel. And it seems that some of the younger members of the Nixon staff were very, very excited about the prospect of arranging this meeting between Presley and the president, and they really pushed for it. So Deputy Assistant to the President Dwight L. Chapin, he writes a memo, which you can see here, to White House Chief of Staff H.R. Haldeman, and details the letter, the request, all of that, and also includes the six-page letter to the president as well. In the memo, he encourages the president to take the meeting rather than pushing it off on his vice president, Spiro Agnew, because if you remember in that letter, he notes that he had previously met Agnew a few weeks prior. Chapin also notes in that memo that it can, quote, be extremely beneficial for the president to build some rapport with Presley. Okay, so now we get to my absolute favorite part. If we go to the second page of this letter, the memo actually gets to Haldeman's desk, and Haldeman does approve the meeting with the president. He schedules it for President Nixon had an open hour, usually within the noon hour. But as you can see here, he writes in the margins of the memo, "You must be kidding," scrawled in the margins. And I just think that's really funny. Later that morning, then you have Deputy Assistant to the President for Domestic Affairs, a man named Edgell Crow, or Bud, as his nickname is Bud. He makes contact with Presley and invites him and his associates to come to the second floor of the old Executive Office Building, which is today known as the Eisenhower Executive Building, or EEOB. Elvis arrives with his friend Jerry Schilling and bodyguard Sonny West at around 10:10 a.m. And Crow actually later wrote a book about this whole day titled The Day Elvis Met Nixon. And he details what they discussed during this meeting. So primarily, they are discussing ways that Elvis could assist the nation's youth through his music to tackle the nation's drug problem. And Crow is really personally very interested in this idea. And he thinks that Presley can help reach the youth, similar to what Elvis sort of laid out in his letter to the president. After this meeting, Crow ends up writing up an agenda for a meeting with the president, and Elvis departs from the EEOB.
So, Lina, you know, you remarked about Haldeman's little comment on that memo, and I have to point out that's really the value of why the National Archives has these original documents in its possession, because it preserves things like these comments that wouldn't have been available on a different copy. The original copy is really important. So I just wanted to point that out.
Yes.
Okay, so after Elvis leaves the building, right? The Eisenhower Executive Office Building, where does he go? Does he go directly over to the White House, or does he do something else?
Yeah, so this is a very important element to the story. It's a little bit confusing, but after this meeting with Crow, before he comes back to the White House for the big meeting with the president, he actually goes to the Bureau of Narcotics and Dangerous Drugs. He meets with staff there, and then he requests this badge, which he writes about in his letter. He wants a badge from the BNDD, and he makes contact with the deputy director, John Finlater, who ultimately denies this request. And the big question here is, why does Elvis want this badge so badly? And the answer is really, really interesting. So Elvis Presley collected various law enforcement badges, and according to his friend Jerry Schilling's memoir, which is titled Me and a Guy Named Elvis, Presley had a really deep respect for law enforcement because they often helped protect him during concerts and other events. So he began collecting honorary badges from various police departments that protected him. A little bit prior to this whole event taking place, he had experienced a significant security threat in Las Vegas prior to this meeting, and he was seeking out credentials that would potentially offer him greater protection. So you have to remember that this is one of the most famous men in the world, and safety becomes a bit big concern for him, and you can tell he's a little bit paranoid about his safety. He had previously tried to obtain a BNDD badge, and his attempts were all denied, including that morning meeting at the BNDD. His wife, Priscilla Presley, shed some light on this, on his reasoning for this, in her memoir, and she wrote, quote, "The NARC badge represented some kind of ultimate power to him. With the federal narcotics badge, he believed he could legally enter any country, both wearing guns and carrying any drugs he wished." So according to his wife, this is sort of probably his main motivation for obtaining that federal badge, in addition to adding it to his collection that he already has. And it's also rather ironic when you consider his stated reasoning for the visit, which is helping with the nation's drug problem.
Right. So Elvis Presley returns eventually to the White House to have his meeting with President Nixon, but there's a small incident with the Secret Service. Can you tell us what that is?
Yes. So Elvis arrives back to the White House around 11:45 a.m. with bodyguard and his friend Schilling and West. And according to Bud Crow gets a call from Secret Service agent named Bill Duncan, who informs him that Elvis has shown up for his meeting with a Colt 45 World War II commemorative pistol in a display case, as we can see here, with silver bullets. And he wants to present this as a gift to President Nixon. And in fact, in that letter, he had alluded to this gift by saying he wanted to deliver a, quote, personal gift to the president. And apparently this was that gift. Secret Service, of course, could not allow Elvis to bring a gun and bullets into the Oval Office. And so, citing security concerns, they accept the gift on behalf of the president. It would become Nixon's later. And now it exists in the collections of the Richard Nixon Presidential Library and Museum, which is why we have this fantastic photograph of it.
So tell us what happens during the actual meeting in the White House. Are they in the Oval Office? And how did they come to take this very famous photograph?
Yes. So the meeting itself is actually very short, considering all of this buildup, all of this lead up. But at 12:45 p.m., Bud Crow ushers Elvis Presley into the Oval Office. And we can, if we go to our next section here, we can talk a little bit about the meeting and some of the photographs of it. So President Nixon actually greets Elvis formally and prefers to address him not as Elvis, but as Mr. Presley, which I think is fitting for the president. If we scroll down, we have the photographs as well, which is what I want to show here. Yes, perfect. White House photographer Oliver F. Atkins, he snaps, of course, the famous photograph of the pair shaking hands. But this is just one in a number, basically a series of photographs that he takes throughout the meeting. So after this initial greeting where he says, "Welcome, Mr. Presley," then Elvis begins to show Nixon his collection of law enforcement badges, which we can see here in this photograph. So in this particular photograph, you can see Elvis has sort of a pile of all of his honorary badges on the edge of the desk. And then he also has two photographs. So the one on the desk, you can sort of see it. It's a little photograph of Lisa Marie Presley, his daughter. And then the one that that President Nixon is holding is a family photograph of Elvis, his wife Priscilla, and daughter Lisa Marie. And if we go to the next photo, we can see that particular image. Yes. So this is the photograph. It's currently in the collections of the Nixon Library. And this was gifted and signed for President Nixon. So at this point, after all the pleasantries are out of the way, then it sort of takes a bit of a turn in this meeting. So Nixon steers the conversation to ways that Presley can help reach the nation's youth. And the singer responds that he can best reach people through his music and just singing. And then in this photograph here, you can see the man in the background is Bud Crow, who helped to arrange all of this to happen. So he was in the meeting as well. And from there, we have sort of a really unexpected turn. So then Presley starts remarking about the Beatles, and he says that the Beatles promoted anti-American themes, which I think throws President Nixon off a little bit. He's sort of surprised by this commentary, but very professional, of course, as the president. So he attempts to maneuver the conversation back to ways that Presley could help with the administration. So by the end of the meeting, Presley emphatically indicates to the president that he is, quote, on his side, and that he had received a lot of support from America over the years, and he wants to sort of repay that to the country. He also notes that he has been personally studying drug culture and was accepted by many Americans, including the hippies. And he asks President Nixon for a badge from the Bureau of Narcotics and Dangerous Drugs. The president agrees, but does decline to appoint him as an honorary agent. By the conclusion of the meeting, Presley ends up, he continues to express his support for the president. And then this, unfortunately, is not photographed, but apparently he draws Nixon in for a one-armed hug with his left arm. And I really wish there was a photograph of that, because it must have been quite a funny moment. And then at that point, Presley also asks if Nixon would greet his bodyguard and friend, so Sonny West and Jerry Schilling. So in this photograph here, we see Nixon talking to West, Schilling, and Elvis Presley. And they had a nice little moment there. And then he decided to gift each of the men cufflinks, which is one of my absolute favorite photographs. So this one right here, we have Nixon is putting on the cufflink on Elvis Presley's shirt while Bud Crow looks on. And then apparently after he gifted the cufflinks to these guys, Elvis remarked, "You know, sir, these men have wives." And then that prompted the president basically to go into his desk, start digging around, and he secured some gold pins with the presidential seal to give to each of their spouses. And that was the conclusion of this very famous meeting. So not very long, very short, you know, probably 15, 20 minute period of time, but it produces one of the most famous photo ops in American history.
Terrific. Thank you for that account. Just as a reminder to our viewers, if you have questions for Lina, make sure you put them in the chat portion of the online program where you're watching. And we'll try to get to as many of those questions as possible after we're done with our discussion. So, Lina, tell us, what happened after this meeting? Did Elvis go home? Did he ever get his badge? What was the outcome?
Yes, I'm glad you asked. Elvis does get his badge. After leaving the meeting, and if we go to our next section of the exhibit, our final section, the aftermath of this whole thing, Bud Crowe, he then accompanies this whole group out of the Oval Office. He takes them to the Roosevelt Room, which is right nearby, where they briefly look at a picture of President Theodore Roosevelt. And then Presley, Schilling, and West join Crowe for lunch in the Navy mess. This is a picture here of the Navy mess actually during the Obama administration. But the Navy mess is a longstanding White House fixture. It was established in 1951 under President Harry S. Truman. And it is a small dining facility run by the Navy, and it's located in the basement of the West Wing. So if you can sort of imagine the scene, unfortunately, there's no photographs of this particular part of the day. But Elvis, dressed in his purple suit, that's right, he was wearing a purple suit to the White House. He was met with shocked stares from other staff members that were already eating. And Crowe writes in his book about the incident, quote, "Even though White House staff members were accustomed to seeing heads of state, athletic champions, and movie stars, Elvis was still the king to many of them and in a class of royalty by himself. They all gaped." And truly, I can't imagine what that scene must have been like, a surprise Elvis visit for White House staffers. And then following this particular lunch, the group heads back to Crowe's office in the old executive office building. And at this point, Deputy Director John Finlater arrives with badge in hand. And if you remember earlier this morning, he said, no badge. But now he comes back with the badge and basically has to acknowledge to Elvis Presley that his original decision had been changed by the president. So, with that, Elvis, West, and Schilling left the building, concluding their impromptu White House visit.
Great. So, you know, in the letter, Lina, Elvis requests that this meeting be kept private. But of course, we have this famous image of Elvis Presley and President Nixon. Did the White House keep the meeting private, or did they immediately go public with what happened at the White House that day?
So I would say that they were actually semi-successful at it for a short period of time. So efforts were initially made to keep this meeting private. The news did not immediately get out. So about a week, about like 10 days afterwards, on December 31st, 1970, Nixon sends a thank you letter to Elvis Presley, thanking him for the pistol, the gifts, which I believe we have that image as well. And he writes, quote, "You were particularly kind to remember me with this impressive gift, as well as your family photographs, and I am delighted to have them for my collection of special mementos." And so today, as I mentioned, that pistol is within the holdings of the Nixon Library, and then Presley's estate, Graceland, houses that BNDD badge. And although those efforts were made to keep it secret, over a year later, on January 27, 1972, a Washington Post reporter named Jack Anderson ends up detailing the visit in a short article called "Presley Gets Narcotics Bureau Badge." As I mentioned, it's just a short, small article, but the story got out there, and now it has been told many, many, many times. So when I was researching for this exhibit and the accompanying web article, I got to read several memoirs of those people that were at the meeting, which was really interesting to get sort of different perspectives on it. So as I mentioned, Bud Crowe, he publishes a book in 1994 that was called The Day Elvis Met Nixon. And then Presley's friend, Jerry Schilling, he publishes a memoir in 2006 called Me and a Guy Named Elvis. That sort of describes both their long friendship and working relationship, but also includes his take on this visit and provides a lot more details. And then finally, in an interesting twist, Elvis Presley actually had a lover in Washington, D.C. named Joyce Bova. And she actually details this whole incident in her memoir, which is called Don't Ask Forever. She was actually a congressional staffer on the House Armed Services Committee, and she may have been the initial reason why he goes to Washington, D.C. after the fight with his family. It's a little unclear, but that could be part of it. And then a few years back, the National Archives, because they, you know, have this photograph and all this stuff in their collections, they hosted a really fascinating discussion with Bud Crowe, who has since passed away, I believe, and Jerry Schilling, about this meeting. And you can find that on YouTube, and it's really worth the watch. I recommend checking out all these books and also that that event at the National Archives. It's really fascinating. And then, of course, to find more information about this and to check out this particular exhibit, definitely check that out on whitehousehistory.org, where we have that displayed on our homepage today.
Yeah. Yes, if you go on whitehousehistory.org, you can see the entire digital exhibit, and you can see the photographs really up close and see a lot of the details that Lina was talking about today. And Lina, if I'm not mistaken, I think that event at the National Archives, wasn't that about a movie that was out, that came out about this day?
Yeah, so there was a movie a few years back that was like specifically just about this particular visit that you can check out that is out there. I've seen it. It's pretty interesting. And then there's just been a lot of Elvis press recently, which is sort of why I thought it would be really interesting to examine this. But of course, there's the famous movie that came out this year, the Baz Luhrmann Elvis movie, which I think is up for several awards this year too. So I recommend that as well.
And it's also interesting, the photograph, we always see it in black and white, but it's interesting. I never knew that he was wearing that was actually a purple outfit. So that kind of, it looks a little black. I mean, it looks black in the photograph, but it was purple. So that would have been very interesting, appearing next to Nixon with that sort of type of outfit on.
Yeah, I really wish this was in color because I think this image is so striking in black and white. But if there was a color version, I think it would just show this dichotomy between the president and, his very official suit, and then of course Elvis Presley and his full outfit. And he has like sort of a cape thing going on. I mean, he's got the whole look.
Right. So we have a number of questions. So let's start in with some of our questions from our viewers. Michael asks, he says, I understand that Nixon and Elvis may have kept in contact after the meeting. Do you know anything about that?
Yeah, so it is said that the two did keep in contact for many years, like leading up until Elvis's death. So I believe that they did stay in touch. I think this meeting really did have a big impact on Elvis, and I think he charmed his way into Richard Nixon's heart as well a little bit.
And Frank asked, what do you know if President Nixon was a fan of Elvis? Did he like his music? And was there any evidence that he listened to Elvis or, was considered himself a fan?
That is a really good question. I don't know specifically. I've gotten the impression through reading all of these documents that he probably wasn't a huge fan of Elvis necessarily. And if you think back on the time period when Elvis originally came on the scene in the 1950s, he was sort of shunned by a lot of members of society. They thought he was too radical, too, a little too crazy. So he didn't really impress a lot of the mainstream people at that time period. And I think that's also interesting in that he was never actually asked to perform at the White House, like a lot of people that were performing around his time. I think he was considered a little too controversial, even though this meeting occurs a little bit later in his career in 1970, when you have people like the Beatles coming on the scene that are now disrupting that music scene even more.
Joanne from YouTube asks a very interesting question. Do you think that this is something that could happen today?
I would say maybe not. I mean, I don't know. Maybe if the most famous singer in the world shows up at the White House, that maybe the president would want to see that person. But I do think that this is sort of a very unlikely set of events. As I mentioned, typically, if you're going to come to the White House and you're a big performer, you're usually actually performing, and you're usually on a specific invite. And most frequently, we see that for things like state dinners. So they'll usually bring in really prominent artists, people that are reflective of American culture, because the White House itself is a stage. It is, a way for the president to show the best of the best, to show that to the American people and to visitors from abroad. So I think probably not, especially with all the security concerns of this day and age. You wouldn't be able to bring that gun in, that's for
No,
sure.
that's for sure. That's for sure. Leslie from Facebook asks, what inspired you to tell this story through an exhibit, and how did you decide to organize the exhibit in this way?
Yeah, I thought it was, there was just so many documents and really interesting photographs. And I think the real inspiration for me was that Haldeman memo where he writes, "You must be kidding," because that's just the kind of thing that works really well if you can visually see it, rather than, describing it in an article or something like that. So I thought that this would just be like a really short little fun mini exhibit. And it sort of lended itself well to having just four little parts. So the letter itself, the everybody rushing around preparing for the meeting itself, and then also what happened in the aftermath. So I sort of divided it that way into four sections.
Jane asks, do entertainers who attend state dinners, do they get time with the president? Do they get personal time with the president?
That's a really good question. I think it really depends on what, you know, everything that's going on, how busy the president is. And if they're coming in for something like a state dinner, obviously there's a lot going on those particular days. Everybody's running around, lots of events. But I think that there can be times where the president will have personal time with an entertainer. The presidents also have particular entertainers that they really like personally themselves. And so in those types of cases, I think you see presidents engaging directly with those particular artists. For example, I talked about Johnny Cash earlier. He's my personal favorite. And he came to the White House several times in several different presidencies, sometimes to perform, sometimes not. So, you know, he came during the Ford presidency, he came during the Carter presidency. I know that Jimmy Carter really enjoyed Johnny Cash's music, and I believe that they set aside some time to actually engage with Johnny Cash himself. So yeah, it really just depends on that person, you know, whether the president actually has a really affinity for that type of music and wants to meet that entertainer.
Stephen asks, did Mrs. Nixon have any reaction to the Elvis visit or perhaps the Nixon children?
That is a really good question. I haven't read anything about what their reaction was. And because this occurs so quickly, it's a short meeting just in the Oval Office. I haven't seen any indication that Pat Nixon would have been there or met him or anything like that. So I don't exactly know what her reaction would have been, but I'm sure she would have been surprised.
David from Facebook asks, did Elvis make any public comment upon the resignation of President Nixon?
That is a good question. I'm not sure off the top of my head. I'd have to look into that. I would wonder. But if they, you know, them keeping in touch would indicate that there was some sort of relationship or respect there. Yeah.
Good question from Jackie from Facebook. What does it mean that this is the most requested photo from the National Archives? Aren't all these photos online?
Yes. Great question. So in the past, so this is, now all these photographs are online, but that has not always been the case. So prior to a time where all these photographs are available online, you could request certain images, get them sent to you in various files or in print copy. And this was the image and is the image that was the most requested. And I think that this translates also to downloads of this image as well in the digital age as well.
Right, in the catalog. And by the way, the National Archives has a new catalog online. You should check it out if you're interested. Much easier to search some of these documents and photographs. Matt from Facebook asks, did any other music legends visit the Nixon White House? And, you know, how did this compare to, like, let's say Kennedy or LBJ?
Yeah, I would say, well, like I said, the Nixons were doing that. They did a concert series. So they did have various artists to the White House, of course, Johnny Cash, as I mentioned. So they did have various entertainers. I think there is a trend throughout the 20th century of presidents having big names, big performers to the White House at various points. And the question of how did it compare with LBJ and Kennedy, also very interesting. I would say Kennedy and LBJ both had a lot of different entertainers to the White House. And I think that they're sort of more credited with specifically having artists and music. The Kennedys, of course, were known for their cultural, you know, having not just singers, but artists, dancers, all of these different types of people come to the White House. And then LBJ sort of continued that particular trend during his time in the White House. But I think Nixon sort of gets put a little bit under the radar. And we, you know, we think more about people like Ronald Reagan, who, of course, comes from a Hollywood background. So during his presidency, he has, you know, tons and tons of entertainers come to the White House. But my favorite particular entertainer that visited the Nixon White House is definitely Big Bird. There's a great picture of Pat Nixon and Big Bird around the Christmas holiday. And so obviously he is a foremost American celebrity for sure.
And First Ladies have met Big Bird and Sesame Street characters all throughout.
Well, yeah.
This is very popular, particularly for First Ladies to interact with Sesame Street characters.
Yes.
Lina, tell us, you know, when you did your research for this exhibit and for the article that you wrote for the website, what is the most surprising thing you learned about this day? What was the thing? I mean, you said that your favorite thing was the Haldeman comment on the memo. What was the thing that you saw that you were really like, wow, this is really surprising or interesting? It made you pause. It made you double check it. or learn more, try to learn more about it?
Yeah, I think the most surprising element was the element of Nixon having this woman, Joyce Bova, that he knew from meeting her prior and knew she lived in D.C. And actually, the story around that is really intriguing. Following, she writes in her memoir that after he meets with Nixon, she actually made contact over the phone with Elvis and he picked her up. And then she describes a really fascinating scene where they're driving down the Baltimore-Washington Parkway and they see a car accident. And like a woman is out lying on the ground. She's injured. Like police are coming to attend to her. And Elvis gets out of the car in that purple outfit that he was wearing to the Nixon White House and goes over and tries to help her and is like, "Hey, I'm Elvis, like I'm here to help," or whatever. And that scene is just really surprising. I wasn't expecting that particular story, which all happens on the same particular day. And I also think that Joyce Bova's memories also help to sort of complete the story. It sort of helps me understand why he was even came to Washington, D.C. in the first place and, you know, what was going on there. But she actually she did an interview in 2015 where they sort of asked her, like, they always exclude you from this story. Like, you're never part of it. You're not usually, like, in all these memoirs, she's not really mentioned. And she said, quote, "Yes, it makes me crazy that I'm never factored into the Nixon meeting scenario. That's one of the reasons why I wrote my book to begin with in 1994. I was sick and tired of hearing the same story over and over again with people lying about it. So I wrote a book instead." And so she writes her story and her sort of memories of this incident as well. And I think that's a really surprising element I wasn't expecting, but was definitely an interesting point.
So one last question from Grant. He asks, what other digital exhibits do you have and what's next?
Yeah, so we just started launching digital exhibits within the past year. So we launched one earlier this summer, which I believe is called Glamour and Innovation. And it's about first ladies and fashion. And it's very interesting. And you can find that on our website, whitehousehistory.org as well. Highly recommend checking that one out. It was done by an intern from NYU. And we were very lucky to have her. And we will be having more digital exhibits now that we have this feature. So this is the second one. But I know that my colleague, Sarah Fling, who's also a historian on our staff, is working on one for spring this year. So stay tuned for that. I'm sure you'll hear more about it. And we will continue to do digital exhibits throughout the next few years. Yeah.
It's a really important medium. It's great to write an article and have people be able to read about things like this day, this historic day at the White House. But to actually see the story through images really can add a whole other dimension to the story itself.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, Lina, thank you so much for joining us tonight for White House History Live. It's been a pleasure speaking with you to talk about this famous meeting that took place at the White House. Once again, if you want to view our digital exhibit or share it with other Elvis fans, you can find it on our website, www.whitehousehistory.com. I hope you'll tune in to our next episode of White House History Live on January 10th. Gail Jessup White from Monticello will discuss her book, Reclamation, Sally Hemings, Thomas Jefferson, and a Descendant's Search for Her Family's Lasting Legacy. Also, for our regular White House History Live viewers, we will be adjusting our timing for White House History Live in 2023. It will now start at 5:30 p.m. Eastern Time instead of 5 p.m. Eastern Time. This new time will begin with our January 10th episode. And we did this because we realized that a lot of people now are returning back to work, perhaps in the office, or have other things that they're doing during the day. And we thought it would be better to allow a little bit more time for people to be able to tune into White House History Live. If you'd like to watch any of our previous White House History Live episodes, please go to our website, once again, www.whitehousehistory.org. Thanks everyone for joining us this evening. And we hope to see you in the new year on White House History Live. Have a terrific holiday season with your family and friends. Good evening.